we'd like to have some questions, comments, suggestions in the time we have remaining, and we're going to try to keep on schedule and start on the speed presentations shortly. But do we have the mic available that we could pass around to anyone who'd like to pose a question to either Dr. Acosta or Philippe Aigran?
Maybe just an additional comment. What you will find in the slides is for each of the nine, I've listed examples, advantages, and drawbacks. So do not believe that I believe that any of these things is without drawbacks. Like, they are obvious in the private investment case, but all of them have drawbacks, have flaws.
Do we have...
My name is Wolfgang Hirschele. I have a comment on Philippe Aigran's talk, specifically your last point regarding the basic income. I'm here. I would argue that the best source for that would be from the things that we own all in common, things like air or other basic natural resources, or in countries that have oil wealth and that sell it abroad, the income from oil, which doesn't properly belong to anybody. If it doesn't belong to anybody, it should belong to everybody. Or if it's air, payments for carbon dioxide emissions could go into a general fund and then go out to everybody. Or watershed usage and water pollution charges could then be paid out to everybody. Because those are our common wealth, and then they should also pay for that common income.
Should I answer that? Yeah. I think, yes, this is clear one possibility. If you look at what Norway decided to do with its income from oil, you know, they created a fund for the future generations, and indeed we also have to think about them, which is a kind of symmetrical, less environment friendly gesture to ITT. But one could have imagined that such a fund could also be used to invest in environment projects and in other commons projects. Actually, I think it was moderately the case. The problem is we have to be careful of not using stock that is non-renewable to fund flows that come every year.
Dr. Acosta, you have a comment?
En relación a la propuesta que se hace allá de conseguir un fondo a través de la explotación de petróleo, hay una iniciativa que está siendo discutida y que fue una iniciativa que surgió de un economista norteamericano, Herman Daly, y que ha sido recogida también por el gobierno del Ecuador y se le conoce ahora como el impuesto Daly-Correa. La idea es grabar a cada barril de petróleo que sale del subsuelo con una cantidad de dinero, no me acuerdo si era hasta $3 por barril, para configurar un gran fondo financiero mundial que permita enfrentar el calentamiento global y construir una alternativa hacia una matriz energética no dependiente de los recursos fósiles, de las energías fósiles, y para que ese proceso de transición no sea traumático para la humanidad, sobre todo para que los países más pobres, que no tienen petróleo y que tienen enormes dificultades para adecuar sus estructuras energéticas y su sociedad a los cambios climáticos, no sufran los impactos. Entonces, es una iniciativa que podría dar lugar a la conformación de un gran fondo mundial que tenga este gran objetivo, que es el de caminar hacia una nueva matriz energética.
Thank you. We have another question right here. We have one time for one more question. I'm sorry, because we're a little bit short. If we're going to keep on time with the power presentations. Yes, sir.
Hello, my name is Joy Sen. I'm from India. I think this session, the second session for us, is a very crucial session in this conference, both because of its timing and because of the subject. While I appreciate, I tried to appreciate as somebody, as a normal layperson, both presentations, what I'd like to ask both the speakers, if you could stand back and ask and explain to us how what you're suggesting, not just for Ecuador, but for the world, what you're saying is a new narrative for the 21st century. I feel that we're still too close to the particular presentations and not sufficiently drawing out general principles looking ahead. We may not agree on them, but I think it's very important that they be articulated, and I'd like to ask whether maybe others in the room would also like to speak to this. I think this is very crucial for this conference that we begin to articulate general principles.
I am dearly conscious of the insufficiency of elaboration of the list I have shared with you, but it has nothing to do with Ecuador. It is designed for humanity. These things are working every day. Voluntary resource pooling is there in every local Indian community, and sometimes even statutory. So I some of the schemes are good for local and physical commons or social commons. Other are better or needed for global commons, in particular, I think, those of information, knowledge, and culture. And there is a real challenge. The problem is when you start thinking about the articulation between the monetary economy and the commons, you have, while you are trying to run into the future, you have something that holds you back very strongly, and we need creative thinkers like are in these rooms for helping us free ourselves of the excessive understanding and acceptance of the schemes that are presently governing the monetary economy. But already a few of the schemes I presented are certainly not orthodox.
Yeah. Dr. Acosta. Tiene razón cuando nos pregunta si es que no hay otras alternativas. Hay muchas otras alternativas y muchos otros proyectos, pero a nosotros dos nos invitaron a hablar de estos proyectos y en concreto de esta iniciativa del ITT, que debo reconocer se enriqueció con el debate internacional. Inicialmente hablábamos de una compensación. Tienen que compensarnos por no explotar el petróleo. Pero eso era una suerte de chantaje internacional. Nos van a dar dinero para hacer algo que de todas maneras tenemos que asumir. En esta discusión internacional se abrió la puerta a la contribución al partir del principio de la corresponsabilidad. Esta iniciativa, Yasuní ITT, cuya idea no tiene ningún gerente propietario, que fue construida desde las comunidades con aportes y decisiones importantes como la del propio gobierno, ha permitido ir enriqueciendo las respuestas y encontrar otras soluciones y nuevos problemas, sin duda alguna. Pero nosotros estamos conscientes, por ejemplo, que este rato, cuando el ministro Nibel dice que Alemania no va a cumplir con su compromiso, podría haber una gran presión de la sociedad civil alemana y de los partidos políticos alemanes que ya se comprometieron con esta iniciativa para hacer realidad la misma. Incluso, ¿por qué no pensar en una iniciativa ciudadana en Alemania para que el ciudadano común, la ciudadana común, puedan contribuir a esta iniciativa y se descuente parte de ese aporte de ese impuesto a la renta? Si el gobierno no quiere cumplir con ese compromiso, la sociedad podría presionar para ser actor directo y activo en la solución de los problemas. Estas ideas que proponemos acá son simplemente ideas para la discusión y para enriquecernos. Y yo estoy aquí para aprender mucho de ustedes. Gracias.
We'll take one more question. I'm sorry that we can't have a much longer discussion. It's partly our schedule, but in the back.
Thank you. I'd like to follow up on that a little bit. The discussions here are mostly in the area of finance.
Please speak into the microphone.
A little bit louder. Okay. The discussion has been mostly in the area of finance, which is good. We've now touched on the monetary aspect, but I still don't think we've really addressed the pertinent question as it relates to the commons, which is, how do we link the monetary system with the commons? Because the monetary system is about value, the commons is about value creation. So how is that connection going to be made? How do our experts recommend that takes place? We've been circling around that problem, but we really haven't addressed it particularly. Do you have any recommendations for us in terms of how that can work? It would certainly have to come from a different kind of metric than the financial. In other words, if we're looking at the value of ecosystem services, that doesn't appear to be the right metric. We need another kind of system. Any recommendations?
Well, I wouldn't dare saying it's a recommendation, but clearly for me, I advocate a relatively clear-cut separation. I prefer schemes that articulate without injecting notions of currency value within the commons, because I, from my own experience, which is mostly with information and knowledge and software commons, but and also my interest for other forms of commons, I tend to think that we might, if we do that, actually bias the normal functioning of the common in a very detrimental manner. But it is clear that this viewpoint I just stated is not shared by everybody. There are groups who build, for example, open money systems to exchange currencies between various commons, or you want to use currencies directly within the commons to measure the value produced within the commons. I think we need measures of value within the commons, but I wouldn't like them to. Currencies are transaction based. And I would like the value to be human assessment based, which is not the same thing. But this is an open discussion.
Dr. Acosta, any final thoughts?
Hay, sin duda alguna, una serie de propuestas que ya han sido enunciadas acá por Philippe, que es la posibilidad del desarrollo de dineros alternativos. Yo creo que eso nos abre la puerta a una serie de reflexiones, pero adicionalmente creo que tenemos que definir algunos principios básicos y fundamentales. A mí me parece importante hacer realidad un proceso masivo de desmercantilización de todas las relaciones con la vida de los seres humanos y con la vida de la naturaleza. Nosotros tenemos que pensar otro tipo de sociedad. La vida no puede estar mercantilizada. No sé si ustedes oyeron hablar de un señor hace más o menos 2000 años, sacó a latigazos del templo a los mercaderes. Igual tenemos que sacar a todos los mercaderes de la vida y de la naturaleza, porque la naturaleza es un templo para la reproducción de los seres humanos. En ese sentido, yo creo que, por un lado, tenemos que aprovechar todas las oportunidades que dan dineros alternativos en este proceso de transición y algunas otras herramientas, como el fideicomiso del ITT, del cual escucharán mucho más profundamente en la tarde y en la noche, pero tenemos que ir estableciendo ciertos parámetros generales y básicos de cómo organizar las relaciones de los seres humanos con la naturaleza. Tenemos que reencontrarnos con la naturaleza. La naturaleza no puede ser vista simplemente como un objeto de explotación y de privatización. La naturaleza es la vida. Los seres humanos no podemos vivir al margen de la naturaleza. La naturaleza podría existir sin seres humanos.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Well, this is obviously a richer conversation that we can handle in 1 hour, but I think we've got some interesting thoughts on the table. Please continue the conversation in the hallway. We're going to begin immediately with the speed presentation.